The situation of care workers, in particularly in places in Europe and England, as well as in the US, I would argue, are obviously in different kind of phases of the coronavirus. One of the biggest problems I think is happening all over the place is the lack of protective equipment, is the lack of clarity from management about how the work will be organized as these cases increase, a lack of training, especially in how things will be organized in the floor shop, right? And in some ways, also a sense of what are my rights in this moment. In the UK, there is the system itself is private and public, but the majority now is private. A lot of it is owned by equity funds. A lot of it is owned by, companies, I would say regional companies or smaller companies that are basically competing with each other to get these contracts from the government. And so what you got is a race to the bottom. Fundamentally, it's an important moment to understand that what we're dealing with, we're not prepared for. But not because, this is random, but because the system has been broken on purpose. The system has been privatized, has been run to the ground in order to privatize it. The care sector points at very important things right now. One of them is the fact that although considered low skill, we understand it to be essential. Today, those workers are essential. Healthcare workers are essential. Workers that are considered precarious and not important, like the economy, logistics, are essential. So we have, at this moment, as essential workers, the power to fight for something more. So I think the idea that the subjectivity changes from workers that are not important to workers that are keeping us alive, keeping us safe, keeping us fed, right, become an important kind of subjectivity change in the politics that we have. And as trade unions, we have to go bold. We have to take the power we were generating, publicly speaking, and then really go offensive, right? And what do I mean by that? Well, one is that we really need to educate, right? We need to do deep popular political education. We need to understand how things got broken, who benefited, and how. And that we also need to kind of go deeper into understanding what is it that we're asking for. Because if we continuously ask for what's in front of us, we will never look up to understand what is necessary in terms of what we call structural change reform, right? So, for example, in social care, we understand that we can fight all we want with the city council or with a privatized company if we don't basically regulate tax evasion, if we don't raise tax on the corporations, if we don't tax the wealthy, if we don't tax the wealth, right? If we don't look at how debt is used to break us and keep us paying high fees and keep, people individually as well as cities that are in debt. How is it that all this financialization and deregulation that has been happening for so many years, what is it that we need to do now, right, to regulate it again? And if we don't do that, then what we risk to do is basically not go after again the mechanisms that keep us broke, right? In the United States, if you look at the bargaining for the common good model, and I'll discuss it a bit because it's important for us to consider it, is the idea that we, as public sector workers in a trade union, when we bargain, we can not only bargain for ourselves, but we have to bargain for the common good. And so, what does that mean? Well, it means that the bargaining demands that we usually have, which is about our own conditions, have to be expanded and have to be expanded around many different things. For example, housing rights. For example, the rights of debtors. For example, the right to, some kind of governance that cares about climate change. That we can, in some ways, demand bigger things than what the trade unions are usually kind of seen to bargain for, which is just themselves. And so the fact that the bargaining for the common good framework says we have to come together with the users, right? So the Chicago Teachers Union are demanding things like housing rights, no evictions during school years for our students, right? No money invested on police that have to actually surveil our children every day in the school, but actually shift that money to after school programs, shift that money to nurses, shift that money to ratios of teachers to students that make sense. That fight and that bargaining table is not just the teachers themselves, but it's the parents and the students, right? Actually going to bargain collectively for each other. We're in a moment where we have to step out of our lane. We have to go fight in the area and the space and the articulation of power. We have to follow the money. We have to understand how financialization has basically seeped through our public infrastructures, and we need to go back and follow that money and by name figure out who has benefited, who has been the perpetrators. And that is one of the things that we're seeing in healthcare as well. How is it that social care in particular? Why are we fighting alone? No, we have to fight for the families and the patients and users. And we have to actually talk about the essentiality and the importance of social care for our social fabric and the reproductive, you know, role of care in particular. So I do think that for us, the shift of going bold and much more bigger in our demands, which is the idea that we need to align in much more powerful ways, that we need to do early bargaining development with our allies, and that we need to align our power in a way that we haven't before. For me, you know, that demands unions that can be much more serious about trying to have a voice in the regulation of capital and in the regulation of the public investment and the way in which the system has been deregulated in order to break the public coffers, in order to break the role of government and to minimize it. And right now we're seeing the opposite of that. We're seeing a moment in which everybody understands that the state has to have a bigger role. Yes. And I think in terms of economics, that's a good thing. In terms of our rights, vis-a-vis surveillance, vis-a-vis social control, that I don't think is so good. And so we have to be very careful about those differentiations. But I do think this is the moment to actually be as socialists, as offensive, as, you know, demanding what is for the common good. And I do think that, you know, we're going to see some serious offensive moves by the right-wing government, and we need to be ready for that offensive.